All right, folks, if you know the song, you can please join in.
This one's Somos El Barco.
Stream sings into the river, the river sings into the sea. Sea sings into the boat that carries you and me. Somos El Barco, Somos El Barco. Yo navego en ti, tú navegas en mí. We are the boat, we are the sea. I sail in you, you sail in me. Now the boat that we are sailing in was built by many hands, and the sea that we are sailing on, well, it touches many sands. Somos el barco, Somos el mar. Yo navego en ti, tú navegas en mí. We are the boat, we are the sea. I sail in you, you sail in me. The voyage has been long and hard, and yet we're sailing still. A song to help us pull together if we only will. Somos el barco, Somos el mar. Yo navego en ti, tú navegas en mí. We are the boat, we are the sea. I sail in you, you sail in me. With our hopes we raise the sails to face the winds once more. And with our hearts we chart the waters never sailed before. Somos el barco, Somos el mar. Yo navego en ti, tú navegas en mí. We are the boat, we are the sea. Sail in you, you sail in me. Built in the home now in Washington, D.C. It's a bourgeois town. Oh, it's a bourgeois town. I got the bourgeois blues, gonna spread the news all around. Me and Martha was standing upstairs. I heard a white man say, don't want no color down there. Oh, it's a bourgeois town. Town. I got the bourgeois blues going, spread the news all around. Oh, home of the brave, land of the free. Don't want to be mistreated by no bourgeoisie. Where it's a bourgeois town. Oh, it's a bourgeois town. I got the bourgeois blues going, spread the news all around. Folks in Washington, they know how to throw a colored man a nickel just to see him bow. It's a bourgeois town. Oh, it's a bourgeois town. I got the bourgeois blues going on, spread the news all around. I tell all the colored folks to listen to me. Don't try to find no home now in Washington, D.C. Lord, it's a bourgeois town. Oh, it's a bourgeois town. I got the bourgeois blues going on, spreading news all around.
Good morning and welcome to the Community Church of Chapel Hill Unitarian Universalist. I'm Bill Rote, a member of the Worship Associates Ministry at our church. Whoever you are, whomever you love, however you arrive at this beloved place, you are welcome here. I want to especially welcome our guests and newcomers. If you're visiting this morning, there's a special note for you on the back of your order of service. For welcoming visitors and newcomers. As we continue with reopening, I want to mention a few things to keep in mind. We are masking inside on Sunday mornings as a way of striving to be an inclusive community. After the service, we invite you to gather in two different areas. The courtyard is a mask optional space for fellowship, and the area behind the Jones Building, which includes the porch, the grassy area, and the playground, is a space where masking is mandatory. We are currently not passing offering baskets, so if you want to make a donation, you can place your donation in the offering baskets as you exit the sanctuary. Our minister is Reverend Tom Below. Today we're having Mary Hulett as the last, certainly not least, of the preaching practicum class. Mary's been a member of our church since 2001. She's been chair of the Immigrant Justice Initiative since its inception. And she's worn many hats at our church, including two terms on the board and one as the chair of the board and co-chair of the previous building committee. A couple of announcements. One, in your bulletin, it makes a note about our church-wide picnic on September 11th. We'll have more details coming. And the second is, it is Tom's birthday today. You can come down here. Happy birthday to Tom. And in the courtyard, we're gonna have some cards on the table so that you can sign for his birthday. Also, if you would, please turn off any cell phones or silence them if you would. And today's Share the Plate is for the Straley Fund for Youth Travel with Marion and Hirsch.
Good morning. It's really great to see you in 3D. I am Marion Hirsch, and I am your Director of Religious Education. And today I would like to invite you to donate to the Straley Fund for Youth Travel for Service, Justice, and Peace. Joe and Lucy Straley were founding members of this congregation and leaders not only in this congregation, but in our area for peace and justice. And one of the things that they did was always work to make sure that youth had opportunities. They raised money for them. And after Joe passed away, we decided to formalize that effort of his to make sure that youth had an opportunity to travel for justice, peace, and service by establishing the Straley Fund. And that both funds individual youth to go and travel in the world for justice and peace and service, but also it funds youth group trips to make them affordable for young people to have these formative experiences. So thank you for your generosity, and it's really great to see you.
Will you please stand as you're willing or able and join us in our opening hymn in the teal hymnal, number 1022, Open the Window. Our call to worship this morning is by Frederick Buttner. Humanity is like an enormous spider web, so that you touch it anywhere, you set the whole thing trembling. As we move around this world, as we act with kindness, perhaps, or with indifference or hostility toward the people we meet, we too are setting the great spider web a tremble. The life that I touch for good or ill will touch another life, and that in turn another, until who knows where the trembling stops, or in what far place and time my touch will be felt. Our lives are linked together. No one is an island. Will you please join me in reading the words for the lighting of the chalice? We are each called to community, to minister to one another, to witness the pain and glory in one another's lives. For in the end, it is the witnessing and the connections made in it that will matter.
Light in the dark of the
Each week we take a time in our service to share personal joys or sorrows we may have. If you would come forward and speak into the microphone your joy or your sorrow briefly in a couple of sentences, place a stone in the water. There's one other addition. With the new Orange County indoor mask mandates, we ask you to leave your mask on during the joys and sorrows.
Hi, my name is Dawn Kerr, and I'm placing this stone for my friend Deborah and her family. Deborah and I connected as moms of NICU babies at UNC. Her son, Avon, age 6, was diagnosed a week ago today with the brain amoeba that causes near-fatal meningitis. And despite all that the folks at UNC did, working with the CDC to have him be the 6th survivor in the world of this. He passed away on Friday morning with his parents holding his hand. And they are just, as you might imagine, just experiencing an unimaginable loss. Avon has 20 8-year-old brothers, and they were just devastated. Those three boys were just like three musketeers. So I just ask that you please hold this family in your heart.
I'm Deborah.
And our daughter Claire, who grew up in this church and is now 25 years old, has gotten married to her fiance, Matt Deiniger, and they have changed their name to DeHaven, so just Claire DeHaven, and they've moved to Providence recently.
That's our joy. Thank you.
Hello, I am Tom Belote, and on behalf of members of our congregation watching virtually, I have two joys that I was asked to place. First, Tracy McNeil, who is Mary LeMay's daughter, who watches us from the Bay Area. She asked me to place a stone for a joy, which is that her medical technology startup focused on women's health and preventing injury from childbirth is, her startup is proud to announce that they have raised $10 million for a launch of their new product, and we share Tracy McNeil's joy. Also, a visitor, Jeannie Jansen, asked me to place a stone. She's grateful for insurance that covers water damage to her home from a leak, and Moore is grateful for a medical test recently that came back and showed that she is does not have cancer. So for that, we hold Jeannie's joy in our hearts.
Hi, my name is Catherine Grodensky, and this week my neighborhood experienced a loss my neighbor Anne Prince, who some of you might know because she is involved in absolutely everything I ever do in the community, passed away unexpectedly a couple of days ago. She had a recent diagnosis, but they were making long-term plans for her to undergo treatment, and she just passed away very unexpectedly. And she is a beloved community member, a beloved neighbor. She's a mother and a grandmother, and just the sweetest, I'm sure, a UU in spirit, and she's just amazing. So please hold Anne Prince and her family in your hearts, because they're definitely shocked and struggling right now.
Hi, my name is Kathy Hodges, and I'm putting this stone for the people of Afghanistan and the difficulties they're going to go through over the next weeks and months and years. And for my friend and former co-worker, Abdur Kotwal, who recently immigrated from Afghanistan and has lots of family there, and what this means for him and his family. They're really on my heart, and I hope they'll stay on yours as well.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Stephanie. This is my first time here. It's wonderful to be here. I did go to a UU church in Vermont, where I moved here from, but we met in a little red barn. It's quite different. I have two joys. One is, as the previous woman mentioned, my favorite cousin has been working in Afghanistan for the last year. She's an electrician, and she's worked in all over in the Middle East for the U.S. Embassies there. And she is got on a flight last night at midnight her time and is due to be here Monday at 3:00. And it's been scary having her over there. So we are hoping she's safe. She doesn't have contact. She doesn't have any internet service until she lands in D.C. So praying for her. And the other joy is I got COVID in January. Doesn't sound like a joy, but, and I'm not a lucky long hauler, but what it has allowed me to do is really step back from what I thought was important and find true meaning in what's really important. And unfortunately, sometimes that takes an illness or a disease, some sort of suffering, but I'm really grateful for what it's teaching me. Thank you.
I place this final stone for all those joys and sorrows that were not mentioned, but are nonetheless quite important. Would you please take a moment for some meditation and sitting with these joys and sorrows? As we sit in the presence of the Spirit of Life within us, we raise these joys and acknowledge them and are grateful for them. And we hold these sorrows close to our hearts for the loss of life, the losses in wars around the world, the losses with earthquakes in Haiti, and we are grateful for coming together as community to share these and celebrate with others and hold each other up. Would you please join in singing Spirit of Life? Our religious traditions instructed us to welcome the stranger. In the Old Testament, we read from Leviticus 19, 33 and 34, when a stranger resides with you in your land, you shall not wrong him. The stranger who resides with you shall be to you as one of your citizens. You shall love him as yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. In the New Testament, we find similar instructions. Matthew 25, 35. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. Hebrews 13, 2. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unaware. But how do we welcome a stranger? Elaine Scarry writes in her article, The Difficulty of Imagining Other People, says the following. The way we act toward others is shaped by how we imagine them. This is true even when the person is a friend or acquaintance. The problem is further magnified when the person is a stranger or a foreigner. Our injuring of others results from our failure to know them. The human capacity to injure other people has always been much greater than its ability to imagine other people. Or perhaps we should say, the human capacity to injure other people is very great precisely because our capacity to imagine other people is very small.
Brink of wisdom, never recognize. realizing that we've arrived.
Love and spirits will live together. We're all swimming to the other side.
We are living beneath the great big dipper. We are washed on the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together. Some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on. Carousel beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side.
Good morning. Welcoming the stranger. 2 years ago, this congregation welcomed Jamie, our first asylum-seeking immigrant. It all came about because after the 2016 election, many of us in the church and community were looking for a way to effectively protest the anti-immigrant rhetoric that had featured so prominently in that election. To be effective, we knew we had to act together, not alone. We are joined in this immigrant justice work by Kahila and many volunteers from the community and other congregations. We had originally planned to welcome a sanctuary guest, but by the time we were ready, the immigrants had decided that it was simply not safe enough, that the risks of going into sanctuary for their families was too great. And so instead, we have welcomed refugees and asylum seekers. We have welcomed 3 refugees in the last few years. Now, refugees' needs are met by refugee agencies. All we do is provide housing for refugees. Asylum-seeking immigrants are different. They're here legally, but they are not permitted to work for at least 1 year. Could be longer. And they are provided no support of any kind by our government or anyone else. Their sole support comes from volunteers and their sponsor. We, at the time we agreed to do this, we didn't know of any other church that was taking in asylum seekers, and we found little or no training on how to undertake this work. So when Jamie arrived, we were pretty much on our own. Jamie has taught us a lot about welcoming a stranger, and I have her permission today to share her story. And I will share some of those lessons. It starts with Jamie, lost in RDU. A 21-year-old transgender woman from El Salvador who spoke no English and difficult to understand Spanish. It's her first time ever on an airplane. She'd flown on a direct flight from San Diego wearing an ankle monitor. She was just days after 6 months of detention at the border. We'd spoken to her on the phone, and while she was still in San Diego, we'd exchanged pictures and phone numbers, so we thought, maybe hoped, that her arrival would go smoothly. Paul Mitchell and I planned to arrive early so that we could meet her as she came into the terminal. As we're driving to the airport, we discovered that her flight had landed over 30 minutes early. How did she feel arriving in an airport with no one there to greet her and no idea where to go? Paul went into the airport to look for her, and I waited outside. Paul searched, and I waited. Paul was able to call her, but she could not tell him where in the airport she was, and she didn't understand him when he told her where to try to go. Time passed slowly. It just seemed like forever. But Paul eventually found Jamie, and they came out to the car. Jamie was noticeable. She's strikingly attractive. She was wearing truly short, very tight shorts, a bare midriff top, very high heels, and a big rose tattoo on her thigh that was at least 6 inches high. Her makeup was perfect. Her appearance made the tracking device, which is quite large around her ankle, really stand out. I admit that Paul and I were both surprised. This was just the beginning of many surprises and a lot of learning. We brought her to the manse. Her new temporary home, where enthusiastic members of our ministry were waiting to have a pizza dinner with salad and one of Ruth Gibson's cakes. We all sat down for dinner, and the Spanish speakers who were present tried to engage her in conversation. She was much more interested in her phone than us. I looked around the table at this group of volunteers. You can imagine them. They looked like us. All white, all middle class, all retirees, all cisgendered. At that time, we were just learning what that word meant. And I looked at Jamie, a 21-year-old transgender Latina from El Salvador. I wondered how we were going to connect, how we were going to communicate on this journey that we were taking together. That night, I was very excited, but also very nervous. In the reading from Elaine Scarry, she says, the way we act towards others is shaped by how we imagine them. This is true even when the person is a friend or an acquaintance. The problem is further magnified when the person is a stranger or a foreigner. The human capacity to injure other people is very great, precisely because our capacity to imagine other people is very small, close quotes. In other words, there's a direct relationship between how well we know or imagine someone and the likelihood that we will injure them, no matter how great and good our intentions. So how do we imagine the stranger? Do we imagine the stranger as we hope or want them to be? In this case, do we imagine the perfect immigrant? Someone who's ready to accept our guidance and be grateful for everything that we do. Someone who shares our goals. Someone who's anxious to learn and eager to succeed. Someone who is, in fact, a lot like us. Jamie's lawyer in detention described her as fragile. We quickly learned that not only did Jamie not know any English, but she could not read or write in Spanish at all. She had had less than a year of education and really had not learned. She can do numbers, but she doesn't know the letters. Her spoken Spanish is difficult to understand, and she had trouble understanding our Spanish speakers. She comes from a very small village, and the combination of the lack of education and the village made it very difficult. As a result of being transgender, she had experienced terrible trauma in El Salvador on multiple occasions. She'd been rejected by her mother. She was close to her father, but he died when she was only 11. She was on her own from the age of 11 with some limited help from an aunt and some siblings. She obviously has impressive survival skills. With this background, rather than the perfect immigrant we may have imagined, Jamie was above all distrustful. She was depressed. She was uncommunicative. She was resentful, oppositional, and seriously ungrateful. Without the ability to relate to Jamie or to imagine her, we tried our best to help or protect her. We had someone spend the night in the manse for her safety and to make her feel more secure. We had volunteers bring her dinner each night and offer to eat with her. We took her shopping for clothes and other necessities. We found out about English classes. We arranged for medical care, tried to teach her to cook, but we were missing the mark. We were failing to meet the stranger where she was. Jamie remained unhappy and withdrawn. She would not eat with anyone who brought food, and she often didn't eat the food. She'd just leave it right where the volunteer had put it down. She did not want anyone spending the night in the manse. We finally learned that she wanted to be treated like an adult, to make her own decisions about coming and going, her own decisions about food, her own decisions about spending money. She had been on her own since she was 11. She did not want parents now that she was 21. Even though to us, through our cultural lens, she seemed like a very immature adolescent. Treating her as an adult sounds so simple, but it was difficult. As any parent knows, letting go is very hard, and that was exactly what we were being asked to do. We had given her a bike, which gave her a great deal of freedom, but should she be allowed to ride it at night? Should she stay out all night and not tell us where she was? How could she possibly understand the risks she faced? We knew that as a transgender woman of color, her risk of murder was higher than any other demographic group. Did she understand this risk? Letting go was awfully hard. We felt so responsible, and this really stretched our ability to live with risk and uncertainty. As we were dealing with these issues, we became more aware of the concept of accompaniment, that our role as a sponsor was to accompany the immigrant on the immigrant's journey. It was not our journey, not about what we think the immigrant should do as framed by our cultural lens and expectations. It's the immigrant's journey. We are there to facilitate their journey. Implementing the accompaniment model, we committed ourselves to try to respect Jamie's wishes. We stopped spending the night. We gave her the freedom to come and go as she wished. We stopped trying to ensure that she had adequate nutrition. And no matter what she bought for food, we withheld judgment. She clearly loved the freedom. And it did get easier, but there were still issues. Jamie was often late in the morning. She'd still be in bed when a volunteer came to pick her up to take her someplace. This was frustrating. It was many months before Jamie acknowledged that she hated to go to sleep and worked hard not to. And then she'd fall asleep in the morning. She hated to go to sleep because she had terrible, terrible nightmares. This helped us, didn't solve the problem, but understanding her PTSD, which is this clearly was a step in our ability to try to understand her. We all had to learn a lot of lessons. For me, I had to learn that it wasn't about me. When I brought her a meal and it went uneaten, it was not about my hurt feelings. When I made an appointment, and I'd like my, with my dentist, treat her for free, and she was a no-show, it was not my disappointment and embarrassment. When I found her a job, and she lost it because she wasn't reliable, it's not about my embarrassment. When she engaged in dangerous behavior, it's not about my fear. When I provided transportation, brought food, got her a job, did any of these things, it was not about my feeling disappointed or used. I had to learn that accompaniment means trying to imagine the immigrant, understanding where the immigrant is and where the immigrant is going, not my expectations be rewarded. Gradually, we began to see Jamie, her wonderful smile, her astounding sense of direction, her gifts, her bravery, and her imperfections, and we had to let go of our assumptions and judgments. We learned to focus on communication and clear expectations. We learned to accept disappointment. It would not be a smooth road, but we needed to learn from our disappointments. And we learned humility. Our guests are proven survivors and do not need to be rescued. They deserve our walking with them, accompaniment, rather than steering them forward. Paternalism, which could be internalized as devaluing life achievements and experiences. We had to learn to accept sitting with uncertainty. Many times there are no clearly right answers. There simply is no perfect approach to this work. 6 months after Jamie arrived, we had another dinner at the manse. Jamie was going to Texas for Christmas to visit relatives that she had not seen in many years and meet children that she had never met. Again, it was Jamie and the same members of the steering committee that we met before. This time, Jamie was fully engaged. She was showing us pictures on her phone of the family she was visiting. She was showing us pictures of the children she had never met. She was giving us contact information, showing us the phone numbers on her phone so that we could have contacts for the people she was going to be visiting. We gave her a duffel bag, and we gave her a card with some money in it. And each of the members of the steering committee personally signed the card, even though we knew Jamie couldn't read it. I learned later that Jamie took pictures of that card, and particularly of our signatures, and sent it to all her friends, because this meant we cared. Jamie's going to have a very difficult time in this country, and there's little that we can do to change that. We provided her a home for a year and started her on her way. She learned to trust us. She was able to file for asylum to get a work permit. She has been living on her own. She has been paying her own expenses for close to a year. She has had jobs. She even arranged for her own COVID shots. Jamie was one of the more difficult immigrants we could have hosted, particularly as our first guest. But Jamie prepared us to be better sponsors, to understand the difficulty of imagining the other. We have learned lessons through Jamie about how to welcome the stranger, that it takes humility, patience, listening, acceptance, respect, and space. We grow to see people as they really are without the walls created by our assumptions and our imagination. May the lessons we have learned serve us well as we move forward welcoming immigrants to a safer place than they have fled, and may our learning continue. If anyone's interested in learning more about our immigrant justice work, we are going to be in the courtyard after the service.
We're going to do a responsive reading. This side to my right will be group one. Over here will be group two, and it's in your order of service. You first saw them by the roadside, waiting, watching. They walked in silence. Small bundles on the backs, clutching other bits in their hands. Fears on the faces of those women, men, and children, frightened of the past, fearful of the future. Will no one understand their pain? Will anyone open a door to receive them? Look again, and you will see familiar people, mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers and grandparents. Listen and you will hear familiar sounds, talking, crying, laughing. Understand and you will know the stuff of which your dreams are made. Love and laughter, security and safety, peace and prosperity are their dreams too. That which is joy to every human heart is not alien to theirs. The peace you long for is that same peace they strive for. We stand together as one, drawing warmth from the same sun and life from the same earth. And though we travel on different roads, we're part of one God, one earth, one universe. There are no strangers, tears shed in compassion. Songs of love and dreams of peace make us all one. Recognize your family in the stranger. Open your door, invite them in to sit at your table, and share your bread. Call no one a stranger whose roots are kin to your own, whose lives all spring for the one great fountain of life. Would you please stand and join us in singing This Land Is Your Land, and the words are in your order of service. Extinguish our chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth,
the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment.
These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Before we join hands to sing Shalom, as we've been doing, if you're uncomfortable holding hands, put your hands across your chest, over your heart. If you're comfortable with holding hands, you can put your hands down if your neighbor grabs that. Let's go ahead and sing Shalom.